good day and greetings to everybody out there in YouTube and internet land and in the jazz world in general. How are you doing? As the late, great queen of the blues, Coco Taylor, used to say in her live shows, she used to scream at the crowd very often, "Are you doing all right out there? How's everybody doing?" You know, I hope you're doing all right. I hope you're doing fine, no matter what the circumstances we're going through today. I'm the Jazz and Blues Audiophile, and I'm here to talk about a great jazz album. I'm going to propose another great jazz album that you should listen to or you should consider acquiring and purchasing if you're into jazz, starting to get into jazz, new to jazz, or already a hardcore jazz junkie, jazz addict like me. But just a general great album that I have to recommend today by the late and great legendary drummer Buddy Rich. This is not one of his big band albums. Buddy made quite a series of great small group recordings, starting way back from his jazz at the Philharmonic days, when he toured with all kinds of other great legendary jazz musicians with the Norman Grant's organization's Jazz at the Philharmonic. But Buddy, first of all, what we have to know, of course, is Buddy Rich is part of jazz history. He's part of drumming history. He's an artist that has definitely influenced several jazz drummers, has had an impact on the general jazz world with his music and his kind of drumming. Whether you like it or not, whether you like the style that Buddy has on the drums or not, you cannot deny the fact that he has influenced, has had an effect on a lot of drummers, even outside the jazz world, of course. He had the reputation, of course, as many know, the wording that followed him everywhere he went was he's the world's greatest drummer. He was always billed, as the world's greatest drummer. Now, whether he was the world's greatest drummer or not is up to debate, of course. But what's not open to debate in my mind is that was he one of the world's greatest drummers? Absolutely. He was definitely one of the world's greatest drummers, one of jazz's greatest drummers. Don't forget, this guy came up through the swing era mainly, but had a background, already had a showbiz background behind him quite a number of years, ever since he was two, started performing with his parents' acts that were in vaudeville. And Buddy could tap dance. He could really tap dance. He could play drums. He could sing. You know, he could do a variety of things. Of course, the drumming was his real, real big talent. And that's, of course, what he focused on for the major part of his career. But when he came up through the years and he got to maturity, came out of his childhood stuff that he was doing with his parents, he came up through the swing era, pretty much. And he was definitely influenced by a lot of great swing drummers, like he cites Chick Webb, even Gene Krupa, and others of the day, Cozy Cole, you know, and those guys influenced his way of playing the drums. And you can tell by the way he plays the drums that he's definitely related to these guys, and definitely their kind of technique and their kind of drumming, which is a technique that is greatly lost today, is today's modern jazz drumming. And sometimes even in the rock, you know, of course, in the rock world and all that, and pop world, it's a drumming style that's almost non-existent anymore. But you can see the influences of these earlier drummers, and then on Buddy, and then Buddy's influence on other drummers can be felt. And that, I think, is undeniable. Also, another thing that's undeniable is that Buddy participated in some absolutely great historical recordings. He also initiated some recordings that I think are legendary and that I think should be widely regarded as masterpieces. And this is the recording, one of these recordings that I'm going to talk to you about today, that I believe is a true masterpiece of jazz. And it's Buddy Rich and his sextet, recorded in 1961. This was 5 years before he started his own big band that he led up until the end. 1966 started his big band, but this is 5 years earlier. And during throughout the 50s and 60s to the mid-60s, Buddy was leading off and off some small groups and made some terrific recordings during those years. They're often not very much, well, people don't pay much attention to them, and they're rather, I think they've fallen rather into obscurity. But we mustn't forget certain things. Buddy played with the legends. He recorded several tracks that were put out on an album, for instance, 1952 by Verve Records, with the great Dizzy Gillespie, Charlie Parker, Thelonious Monk, Curly Russell is at the bass, and Buddy Rich is at the drums, and they put out a record called Bird and Diz in 1952, which is Charlie Parker, Dizzy Gillespie, as I said, Curly Russell on bass, Thelonious Monk on piano, and who's at the drums? Buddy Rich. And I was just listening to this recording recently, and it's a heck of a bebop recording. It's one of the earliest, great, great fine examples of bebop playing, of course, by the two legendary musicians, which were Dizzy Gillespie on trumpet and Charlie Parker on the alto saxophone. And who's on the drums? Well, Buddy's on the drums, and he's doing one hell of a job backing these guys up. He's really drumming up a storm behind these guys and playing in a style that it makes no difference to him. He once said in an interview many times, he says, when you're a drummer, you got to play everything. You got to be able to play everything. You got to be able to play with a small group. You got to be able to play hard swinging, hard driving jazz. You got to be able to play big band. You got to be able to play whatever. And I think Buddy demonstrated this pretty much throughout his career. He was able to adapt to just about any situation and play in any kind of group and really, really make it sound really good, because he was a consummate professional drummer and one of the legendary great drummers, truly great legends of jazz drumming. Now, people don't agree with that. Often they have a personal grudge against the man because they don't like the man's personality. Now, he had a reputation, but he had a reputation for it being someone with very strong opinions. And he was very vocal about his opinions, and he did not hide them, and he did not water them down, and sometimes it probably hurt certain people's sensibilities for him to talk very roughly and brashly on certain subjects, especially when he criticized country music, which he detested. But the music business in general, he very, very much despised from his interviews that I've listened to. I think he very much despised the music business and the top 10s and the top 20s and all that crap. He hated that because he was really about the love of musicianship, great quality musical stuff. And he promoted that he was very much about. And he didn't like the commercial pop stuff that was being put out and promoted as the best stuff that there was out there, the top 10 and all that. He was very critical about that, and I think rightly so. But nevertheless, whatever you may think about him, you know, a lot of people, as I say, who are very much against recognizing this man's talent and give him his proper due in the jazz world are people that very often did not like his overall personality or his opinions. Well, if you can, you have to sort of disassociate the opinions from the man's musical ability. And if you do that, you cannot dispute the fact that this man was of tremendous, huge musical ability. I mean, I saw the Buddy Rich Big Band 3 times live, and I'll tell you something. Buddy brought the house down every single show. There was just no way that he was not going to bring the house down by the end with one of his huge, powerful numbers like Good News, West Side Story medley, or Channel One Suite, which were tour de force jazz performances. Absolutely fabulous stuff, and I miss hearing those things. I miss being able to see this man live and do and work his magic on the drums like he did, because it was a unique phenomenon. And so, now, this was the interlude, the beginning interlude, but I really want to recommend, and this is what this program is all about, this is, if you want to discover some great albums, this is what it's about. This is what I want to suggest today. This great album recorded, as I said, in 1961 by Buddy Rich's sextet, called Blues Caravan, 1961. It was recently reissued on Verve Records in 2005 as a limited edition, of course. Only a certain number of copies were put in print, were issued in 2005. So if you want to get this new, I don't think it's available anymore unless they plan on reissuing it again. But you can certainly find it in the used stores. Maybe some stores still have some in stock, who knows? And also, you can probably order it as a digital download, I would imagine, and buy it as a digital download in digital format if you're into that. If you're in the vinyl, I don't know what the availability of this record is on vinyl. You might be able to find the original circulating around there somewhere. If you get your hands on the original issue, well, you're getting a very good copy. But as a reissue, I don't know if it was reissued on vinyl. I have no idea. In 2005, it was, if they put it out also on vinyl. But nevertheless, this is what I'm talking about when I'm talking about great jazz, legendary jazz recordings. This thing, this album, Buddy had picked five musicians to play with him. And these five musicians, I'll tell you who they are. There's Buddy, of course, who's at the helm, at the drums. Sam Most is on flute. Now, Sam Most is considered by Leonard Feder, one of the great jazz critics, probably the first great jazz flutist in jazz history. Sam Most, who passed away, I think, in 2013, a couple of years ago. Sam Most is on flute. Rolf Eriksson, the great Rolf Eriksson, who is a Swedish jazz trumpet player, who was coming to the States in the 40s, came to the States in the late 40s, went back to Sweden, came back in the mid-50s, went back to Sweden, came back at the beginning of the 60s, and I don't know if he stayed in the States finally or if he went back to Sweden again, but this is when Buddy picked him up in 1961 for this group, one of the great, great European jazz trumpet players. Mike Manieri on vibes. Now, Mike Manieri was a fiery, just razor-sharp, fast vibe player, full of drive, you know, and fire. It's just incredible to listen to him on these tracks. He's just a wonderful, wonderful vibraphone player, very much overlooked, I think, in jazz history, and he's still active today. One of the few musicians of this group who's still alive and still active today. There's only two that are still alive, as far as I can tell, and Mike Manieri is one of them. Then there's Wyatt Ruther on bass, and Johnny Morris on piano, the great Johnny Morris, a great, great jazz pianist who's still going strong, 84, I believe, today, and lives in New York City. I know he's not going strong by it right now because we're in a pandemic confinement situation, but nevertheless, up until recently, he was still playing on and off in the clubs, apparently, on piano. So, this is the group also that Buddy toured part of the world with in 1961 because the State Department asked him to go on tour with these guys to Asian countries in the Far East. Here's a list of the countries he went through in 1961, just very interesting, just prior to recording this album, 2 days after recording this album, he was taking this group around the world. They went as part of the International Cultural Exchange Service. They were sent by the United States State Department, and they were sent over to Kabul, Afghanistan. Then they traveled a route which included fairs, outdoor theaters, tent shows, and the like in such spots as Kathmandu, Nepal, Bangkok, and other cities in Thailand, Nam Phom Penh, Cambodia, Laos, Jakarta, Indonesia, Singapore, Hong Kong, Saigon, Vietnam, Calcutta, Bombay, and New Delhi, India, and other Asian cities throughout until the end of 1961. So it was quite a tour he embarked with these musicians. So he picked some really good guys to go and play with him. And one of the great characteristics of being a great jazz musician, whatever instrument you're playing, is the ability to be able to lay down a really solid jazz groove. A hard-driving, hard-swinging, solid jazz groove. And this is what this group does. This is what Buddy does. And I gotta say, on this album, one of the great Mozart of jazz, the great Duke Ellington, the one and only, the aristocrat of jazz, if there is one, and one of the greatest composers in jazz. People say that he's got at least 1,000 different compositions to his name, Duke Ellington. Composed one of the absolute gems of jazz, one who's been played by thousands of musicians all across the world, the great number Caravan, which he recorded with his own big band back in the, I think it was in the early 30s that he composed this and recorded. And recorded several versions. Of course, Ellington put out several versions over the years of his own Caravan. But this album, for me, holds the best, my favorite, all-time favorite version of Caravan. And Buddy lays down a groove, lays down a musical background with his drums right from the start. And then the flutist, you know, Sam Most, comes in with that flute and starts playing that Caravan melody. And this is one hell of a groove. I don't care who you are. I don't care what group we're talking about. This is a groove that's comparable to any of the great, great jazz groups out there. Anybody at all. And I'm going to let you hear a couple of seconds of the beginning, maybe a minute or two of that song. I can't play these songs all together outright on the internet. And anyway, the sound is not all that good over this cheap little microphone I'm recording on. But it gives you an idea of what this album, part of this album, sounds like. Here's that great beginning of that great version of Caravan. And listen to the drums. Listen to Buddy just laying out that powerful Thunder House drums. Mover were Art Blakey. This is just as much as powerful as any drumming that Art Blakey was known as, a thundering drummer. This is just as powerful as anything that Art Blakey ever laid down. Listen to the groove that he's laying down for his band, as for his soloists on Caravan. Here it is. Feel the caravan coming on. Recording features some great drumming and great playing by all the musicians. And there goes a swing. Wonderful. Just wonderful jazz. Now, this album is excellent. I mean, I highly recommend it. Nothing is bad on these. There's only six tracks on this album. All six are wonderful, wonderful pieces of music, wonderful pieces of jazz, and I think they are part of jazz history now. Recorded in 1961 for the Verve label and recently reissued 2005. I'm sure you can find this album somewhere. It's a jazz classic, an absolute masterpiece in my opinion. And I mean, the musicians on this, as I say, they get a chance to express themselves fully. Buddy is playing wonderfully. He's got some great cymbal work, especially his cymbal work. You heard it there on the beginning of Caravan. He's got some impressive cymbal work in the background of his musicians, I find. And throughout the whole album, his drumming is very, very interesting because it's a different kind. It's still powerhouse drumming. Buddy was known for powerhouse drumming. He was not a light player, you know. He was known for powerhouse drumming, but it's interesting to hear him in this context of a small group context, because he really has a different way of expressing himself, even if he's always playing in the same vein and the same style. Of course, he's got that huge sound about him, but still, it shows you a different facet of the man. When he was playing with a small group, what was he doing behind the soloist? What was he doing as far as drum breaks are concerned and accompaniment and all that? It's very, very interesting to hear his drumming in these small group sessions. And he did a series of small group recordings also, even when he started his big band in 1966. Mustn't forget that Buddy had a club in the mid-70s, I think around 1974, he opened Buddy's Place, and he often played with a small group at Buddy's Place, and he has recorded. There are some recordings out there, live recordings, made at Buddy's Place, which again, feature Buddy on a small group drumming, you know, small group drumming, and very, very interesting to listen to him in these contexts, these more intimate contexts where he's not with a big band, but just with a couple of musicians. So, this is my recommendation for this week to lose the coronavirus blues. Get yourself some good jazz, and this is a great place to start. Buddy Rich, Blues Caravan, recorded in 1961 for the Verve label. I'm the Jazz and Blues audiophile. It's been a little rant on this album. If you like these kinds of presentations I make on great jazz albums, go ahead and subscribe to my channel. I put out videos pretty regularly, especially in this confinement period. And go ahead and comment. Let me know what you think about this recording. You think this is one heck of a great, legendary recording by the great Buddy Rich and his sextet here? Is it or is it not? Is Buddy one of the greats or not? Hey, you're entitled to your opinion. I don't have to agree. You don't have to agree with mine. You can let me know what you think. I welcome the opinions, and I often, most of the time, I respond to my comments. So, until next time, when I come back to you and present to you another one, another fine jazz album. Listen to that drumming, man. I'm the Jazz and Blues audiophile. I'm saying bye-bye for now, and talk to you in the next video. Bye-bye.